Yeah, from past three sessions, we have been dealing with the topic called as suppositories and pessaries. Okay, in the first session, we have dealt about definition about suppositories and pessaries, advantages and disadvantages of suppositories and pessaries. What are the ideal properties for a base to be formulated into suppositories and pessaries that we have come across, and followed by what are the types of bases used for formulating suppositories and pessaries. There are four types of bases: fatty bases, hydrophilic bases, water dispersible bases, emulsifying bases. That all are your first session. In the second session, we had a continuation of the bases again, and we have dealt with methods of preparation of suppositories: hand molding method, fusion molding method, and compression molding method. These are three methods used for the preparation of suppositories. And next, we have gone through an example, boric, for the preparation of boric acid suppositories. Okay, that is your second session. And in the third session, we have dealt with an excellent topic and interesting topic called as displacement value and calculation. Okay, so in that, definitely you will expect a question in your examination. So displacement value and calculation, just try to go through again through that particular calculation. Okay, if you miss any classes, just go through my YouTube channel. You can find the videos over there. Okay, yeah. Yeah, today's topic is evaluation of suppositories. Today's topic is evaluation of suppositories. So what do you mean by evaluation? Why it is important to go for evaluation? So any formulation you prepare in laboratory or in industry, whatever it is, so you know that by taking utmost priority, you will select all the ingredients, okay? And after selecting all the ingredients, you will look for compatibility issues. And after that, you will formulate the product. After formulating the product, what you need to be checked for? You need to be checked for assessment of your formulation, okay? So assessment is nothing but, okay, you have prepared your formulation now. Whether your formulation meets all the requirements, what requirements? All the specific requirements like color, order, taste, all your evaluation, whether it meets all the requirements or not, you need to assess your product. After assessing, then after that, you'll go for analysis. So when you say analysis, you need to test your product. After testing your product, you'll come to a conclusion. On that conclusion, you need to check the performance of your product. After checking the performance of your product, so if there is any default associated with the product, what you need to do? You need to improve your product. Improving your product is nothing but you need to just reformulate your product then and there. Okay. So after reformulating your product, again, what you do? Again, you will assess, again, you will analysis, and again, you will performance. Okay. And again, you will be checking for performance. After completion of this, at the end of the day, you will be getting something called as results. Okay. After getting the results, if these particular results meet the specific requirements specified in individual monographs, as I said that any product will not be prepared in one country. It might be prepared in US, it might be prepared in other European countries and all. Every country will be having their own what? Pharmacopoeias. Okay. European countries will be having European pharmacopoeias. US countries will be having United States pharmacopoeia. India as a country, we will be having Indian pharmacopoeia. So a product prepared in any country, it has to meet the specific requirements specified in that particular pharmacopoeia. Okay, there are some limits specified in the pharmacopoeia. When you prepare a product, your product results should meet the requirements of the requirements that have been mentioned in that particular pharmacopoeia. When it meets, then it says that your product is ready to be entered into the market. So when your product is ready to be entered into the market, what you need to do? You just put your product into the market. After putting onto the product into the market, it is not that you have completed your task. So you need to wait for some time. That sometime is nothing but called as post-marketing surveillance. Post-marketing surveillance. So after the product entered into the market, you'll be getting a feedback on the product. And who will give you the feedback? Either the your physician professionals or your pharma professionals will give you the product after entering into the market. For example, see a particular person suffering from so-and-so disease. He has gone to a physician now. What physician will do? He will prescribe a dosage form. as we are discussing with a topic called a suppositories. Now a pediatric child was there, and he is suffering from some constipation problem, and he had moved to the physician. That particular physician had prescribed something called as insert dulcolax suppository, and the route of administration is rectal route. After inserting the dulcolax suppository, so what is the administration problem that has been faced by the consumer? That is very important. And after inserting, whether it is going to produce the therapeutic effect, that is also important. When it is not going to produce the therapeutic effect, what will happen here? That consumer again will move back to the physician, okay, and he will just complain about the dulcolax suppositories. That, see, you have prescribed dulcolax suppositories from past 3 days. We have been on medication for that dulcolax suppositories, but it's not working. So that physician will not immediately respond to your query, but what he will say, just I'll change the dosage form or medication and I'll give it to you. This physician, internally, he will give a feedback to the pharma professionals, okay, pharmaceutical industry professionals, that see, so and so marketing person has visited us and he has given so and so dosage form. This is our feedback on the dosage form. That feedback might be good or bad. So all these things will come under some concept called as evolution. So any dosage form that has been manufactured or prepared, it has to be evaluated. It has to be evaluated for what? It has to be evaluated for assessment, analysis, performance, improvement, results, and feedback. Yeah, going on to the evolution aspects. So here, evolution of suppositories, the first evolution parameter is shape. Okay, so it is advisable to check the shape of the suppository to see if it is consistent irrespective of whether the suppository is hoagie or torpedo shape. So these are all, shape is nothing but a visual observation. Surface condition, it is also a visual observation. Color, it is also a visual observation. Order, it is also a visual observation. All these things can be observed visually. So first, coming to the first aspect, shape. So what shape we will expect for a suppository? We expect for a suppository shape called as hoagie or torpedo. So hoagie is nothing but it is something related to the torpedo shape. Okay, hoagie or torpedo shape, otherwise called as bullet shape. And apart from seeing for the shape, you should also check the consistency of your suppository. That is also very important. This is first evolution, shape. Next, surface condition. The following can be checked. So you need to check for the brilliance of your suppository. The suppository should look like a brilliant mark. What do you mean by brilliant? So what it has to give an aesthetic appearance, ma. Okay, while seeing, it has to produce a aesthetic appearance. Okay, and after that, dullness should be there for your suppository, and you need to check for mottling. So what do you mean by mottling? Unequal distribution of color is called as mottling, ma. Unequal distribution of color is called as mottling. This particular terminology will be used in the preparation of tablets, but normally it will be used in suppository also. So it is not about unequal distribution of color. It might be unequal distribution of any substance is something called as mottling. Yesterday, do you remember while discussing method of preparation of suppositories? Okay, I have discussed about boric acid suppository. You know that boric acid is insoluble in nature. If that particular boric acid is not solubilized completely into your base, ultimately you will see something called as mottling. Some white dots will be absorbed onto your suppository. That means that your boric acid has been not uniformly dispersed throughout your suppository base. So what do you mean by mottling? Unequal distribution of any substance is called as mottling. It might be your API, it might be your color, it might be excipient. Next, cracks. You need to check for the cracks on the suppositories. After that, you need to check for the dark regions on the suppository. So you need, if you prepare a suppository, that suppository color should be uniform from top to end. You should not see any sort of dark spots or dark regions on the suppositories. After that, followed by axial cavities. Are there any projections over your suppositories that are nothing but axial cavities? So your suppository should be smooth enough on all the sides, and it should not have any sort of cavities present on the suppositories. After that, burst, ma. Okay, some unequal shape of your suppository is nothing but called as burst. Okay, next, presence of air bubbles. Presence of air bubbles on the suppository, that also should not be there. And if you are finding any holes also, you need to be checked for the supposition. There should be no holes present in the supposition. All these are nothing but checking the surface condition of the supposition. If you can observe all these things, ultimately you need to discard your suppositories. That's all about your surface condition. Next, coming to the color. The intensity, nature and homogeneity of the color should be verified. Okay. So, as I said that particular suppository, any suppository you prepare, if you add a coloring agent, one type of colored suppository you will be getting. If you don't add any coloring agent like your cocoa butter, what you have done? You have taken some boric acid and added to cocoa butter. You have taken phenol and added to cocoa butter. The color of that particular suppository is light yellow in color. The color of the suppository is light yellow in color. So that particular light yellow color should be homogeneous throughout your suppository. Okay. That intensity and nature and homogeneity should be checked for the suppository. Next, coming to order. Okay. So, verification of order can prevent confusion when similar suppositories are processed. Why we need to check for the order? For example, I am running a company. My company is meant for manufacturing suppositories. So, I will be preparing some 15 to 20 different types of suppositories. So, as we know that the prime importance for a suppository base will be given to your cocoa butter. If all the suppositories are prepared from cocoa butter, ultimately, you will be having a similar order for all the suppositories. When you keep two different types of drugs at same place, ultimately, here, there it will lead to a confusion. Because both the suppositories are having same order, both the suppositories are having a same mold of 1 gram, and both the suppositories are of same size. So, what will happen? Here, it will lead to confusion. So, if you add some ordering agents to that particular suppository, ultimately, you can just differentiate, okay? And here also, there is something with your order. A change in the order may also indicate your degradation process. For example, today you have prepared a suppository. You have got some order with the suppository. It's a fresh order. And after storing it for some period of time, ultimately, if there is any degradation that has been carried out with the suppositories, ultimately, what you can check here, you can check something called as you can say that particular suppositories has been subjected to degradation and you can discard that suppository. So change in the order, it is an indicative for degradation process. As I said you that in your previous classes, if you can remember, cocoa butter is the base. It is ready to rancidify. If you remember that point, it is ready to rancidify if you left to the atmosphere. Because there will be an oxidative reaction that takes place and it will undergo rancidification. When it is undergoing rancidification, what happens? Ultimately, it will lead to false order. So, that particular change in order, that definitely you can say that this suppository has been subjected to degradation. Okay. Yeah, next. Next evolution parameter, weight variation. Next evolution parameter, weight variation. I hope everything are making a note on each and every evolution parameter because these are very important parameters. Okay, weight variation. So what do you mean by weight variation? So all the suppositories made by the respective bases were weighed and average weight was calculated. So for example, you are preparing suppositories for different kinds of drugs. Okay. For A drug, you have prepared about 500 suppositories. For B drug, you have prepared about 500 suppositories. How to check the weight variation? So, as we said that, each suppository should weigh about 1 gram. If you say that, so from that particular A lot, A containing 500 suppository lot, from that you need to take 10 to 20 suppositories and you need to take the individual weight of each suppositories and finally you need to calculate the average weight. Okay. Then all the suppositories were individually weighed and the variation from the average was calculated. No suppository should deviate from average by more than 5%. So after, for example, if you have taken 20 suppositories from a lot and you have calculated individual weight, from that you have calculated the average weight. After calculating this, so here there is a specification given, limit given, that no suppository should deviate from average weight by more than 5%. If you check the individual weight of one suppository, that particular suppository, it should not deviate from your average weight by more than 5%, plus 5% and minus 5%. This is the deviation fix. Except 2, which may deviate not more than 7.5%. Out of 20, if you say, so first statement, it has been given that no particular suppository should deviate from average weight by more than 5%. So this is the first statement. Second statement, we are saying that if any suppository that deviates from the average weight, okay, only 2 suppositories are allowed to deviate, not more than 2. If not more than 2 suppositories are deviating, then your 7.5 for 2 suppositories, 7.5% limit will be acceptable. If it is more than 7.5 or if it is more than 2 suppositories that are deviating, ultimately the entire batch should be discarded. Ultimately, the entire batch should be discarded. This is about your weight variation. Okay, weight variation is nothing but individual weights, average weight. Here there are 2 deviation limits have been given. One is 5%, the other one is 7.5%. 5%, no suppository should deviate from average weight by more than 5%. That is the first statement. And the second statement, that if any suppositories that deviates from the batch, only 2 suppositories may deviate, not more than 7.5%. It can deviate, but it should not be more than 7.5%. If it goes beyond 7.5 or if more than 2 suppositories are deviating greater than your 7.5, the entire batch should be discarded. Clear? This is about your weight variation. Next, coming to a mechanical strength or crushing strength. Mechanical strength or crushing strength. Next, evolution parameter. Suppositories can be classified as brittle or elastic by evaluating the mechanical force required to break them. So what is this mechanical strength or crushing strength? It tells you what is the force required to break the suppository. It will tell you what is the force required to break the suppositories. By that, what we will come to know? We will come to know the brittleness or elastic nature of your suppositories. We'll come to know the brittle or elastic nature of the suppositories. Whether the suppository will be easily break down or it will be elastic in nature. It can be checked by studying an evolution parameter called as mechanical strength or crushing test. Okay, this test is nothing but it lays on the principle called as force required to break them is nothing but called as mechanical strength or crushing strength. Okay, so how this test will be carried out? Can you see the image here? This is the testing parameter. Okay, this apparatus is the testing parameter, you know, for mechanical strength or crushing. Tests are used that measure mass in kilograms that a suppository can bear without breaking. A good result is at least 1.8 to 2 kg pressure. Okay, so a good suppository is said when a particular suppository can hold a pressure of 1.8 to 2 kg pressure. Okay, so in the example laboratory setup shown in figure, the suppository is positioned in upright position and increasing weights are placed on it until it loses its structure and collapses. The purpose of this test is to verify that suppository can be transported under normal conditions and administered to the patient. So how this test will be carried out? First, what you need to do, you know, you need to place your suppository in upright position. After placing the suppository in upright position, okay, you need to keep on applying the weights in kilograms onto the suppositories. Okay, the weight at which your suppository loses its structure and collapses, that particular weight should be recorded, and it should be recorded in kg pressure. Okay, that machine will record the weight. So an ideal suppository weight, ideal suppository should withstand the pressure about 1.8 to 2 kg pressure. Then only you can say that suppository is a good one. Okay, if it collapses before, that means that suppository is not a good one. If it collapses above 2 kg pressure also, it's not a good one. It should be between 1.8 to 2 kg pressure. Less than 1.8, it is brittle in nature. More than 2, it is elastic in nature. What we need, we don't need brittle, we don't need elastic. Your suppository should maintain an optimum pressure. Okay, why this test and why it is important to maintain this 1.8 to 2 kg pressure, you know, because for transportation, because you will after manufacturing your suppositories, you will wrap in a wax paper, then you will put it into transportation and it will be subjected for prolonged storage life. Okay, in that particular transport conditions and storage life, it has to maintain its integrity. That is very important. Okay, the other advantage is that when you take that suppository from the package, you should be in a position to hold, you should be in a position to handle the suppository. At the same time, you should be in a position to insert into the rectum. So till that point, taking from the packet and insertion into the rectum, it has to maintain its integrity. So in order to maintain this integrity and in order to check this integrity, you need to, that suppository should withhold the pressure about 1.8 to 2 kg pressure. Is it clear? This is about your mechanical strength or crushing strength. Next, melting range, melting point, melting zone. Next, melting range, melting point, melting zone. Yeah, what is this evolution parameter? Okay, till now, whatever we have idea on suppositories, we know that melting point plays an important role in suppository. Any suppositories that should be prepared, it should be considered by considering the melting point only, you have to prepare. Because during your cocoa butter, you might have come across. Do you remember? While melting your cocoa butter, you need to be very careful. Less melting or more melting, it will lead to some stable and metastable polymorphs, etc. Okay. So melting point is an important aspect here. So melting range or melting zone is the term often preferred by some rather than melting point. So instead of referring this particular point, melting point, I think you might have done the melting point evolution in your chemistry laboratories by using melting point apparatus. So rather than using melting point, we will use a terminology. So melting range or melting zone also. Okay. So many suppositories bases and medicated suppositories are mixtures and so do not have a precise melting point. When you say a suppositories, okay, that bases or medicated suppositories, whatever they are nothing but called as mixtures. It is a mixture of your API and a base. It might be a mixture of your API and two base. It might be a mixture of API and three base. So when you say this many types of bases, when it comes into picture, we cannot say what is the precise melting point of so and so base present in the formulation. So the release rate of the suppository is related to its melting point, whether you agree this with this statement or not. The release rate of the suppository is related to its melting point. Okay, if you can remember, always suppository release rate will depend upon the melting point. Why? Because while during the formulation, you are more concerned about the melting point. After completion of the formulation, when you insert into the rectum, due to the body temperature, the suppository will start melting. Do you remember what is the mechanism involved in suppository? After insertion into the rectum, the suppository first it will melt. How it will melt? Either it is to the temperature that comes and it will melt your suppository, or it may absorb the moisture that is present in the rectal cavity. This is the two ways where the suppository will start melting. Melt, after that it will soften. Then after that, it will dissolve. This is what happens. By this, we can say that the release rate of suppository is related to its melting point, because your release rate is dependent upon the melting point of your suppositories. It is therefore critical that this test be evaluated using a non-destructive method. So you need to test the melting point for your suppository, but it has to be evaluated using a non-destructive method. What do you mean by destructive and non-destructive method? Destructive method is the method where you will destroy the sample. Non-destructive method is the method where you will not destroy the sample. So the melting point determination in chemistry lab is a destructive method. Okay, taking some substance, putting into a capillary tube and just heating it, when it gets liquefied, then ultimately you say that this is the melting point. It's a destructive method. Non-destructive method, you are not going to destroy the product. Okay, so that is the difference. Why? Why you need to use non-destructive method? Because overheating of your suppository base or your suppository will result in what? Conversion into stable and metastable polymorphs. That is very important. Okay. A number of different techniques are used to study melting behavior, including the open capillary tube method you can use, the U-tube and the drop point methods. There are a number of techniques are there. Okay. For studying the melting behavior. There are open capillary tube, U-tube and drop point method. In general, the melting point should be equal to or less than 37 degrees centigrade. Keep this in mind. This is a specific limit. In general, the melting point should be equal to or less than 37 degrees centigrade. A non-destructive method must be used, as I said, because if the suppository is melted before a measurement is made, the suppository constants may be transformed into a metastable state, as I said you before now. Okay, just now I said about the conversion of its forms. So you need to be very careful to employ the method. So the method employed is a non-destructive method. When you use a destructive method, ultimately it may get converted into a metastable state. Okay. The melting point can also be determined by placing. So what is this non-destructive method? Just we are going to see the procedure. The melting point can also be determined by placing a small diameter wire into the mold. So what you need to do? So you have got a suppository mold, right? So in that mold, you will be having a cavity for your suppository. In that cavity, you need to place a small diameter wire. Okay. So after that, what you need to do, you need to pour your suppository into the mold. Okay. And allow it for solidification. Allow it to solidify. Okay. So after solidification, what you need to do, you know, this particular suppository should be immersed in water. So after immersing in water, it is immersed into a water held by the wire. Okay, it's an imaginary mold. Just think that you have a mold. To that mold, you will be having a cavities for pouring your suppository mass. In that, you place a small wire at the center. Small wire. Okay, thin wire, you place it at the center. And after that, pour your suppository mass into the mold. And just leave it for some time. What after leaving for some time, what will happen? That mass will go into setting. That is nothing but solidification. After that, open the mold, remove the suppository from the mold. What you can see, a wire that is clinging to the suppository. After that, you just immerse this particular wire containing suppository in water. Okay. And after that, you just raise the temperature of the water slowly about 1 degree centigrade every 2 to 3 minutes. Just 1 degree centigrade you increase, keep it for 2 to 3 minutes. After that, more 1 degree, keep it for 2 to 3 minutes. More 1 degree, keep it for 2 to 3 minutes. This is how you need to just keep on increasing the temperature. Until which point? Until the suppository slips off the wire, this is the melting point of the suppository. So as you keep on increasing at one particular temperature, your wire will slip from your suppository because it will start melting, right? So when it starts melting, ultimately your wire will get loosened and it will just slip off from the suppository. So that particular point is called as melting point of the suppository. Are you clear? I think everyone are clear with the method used for the determination of melting range for suppository. Next comes your next evolution parameter is liquefaction time and temperature. Make a note, liquefaction time and temperature. What do you mean by liquefaction time? The point at which your suppository will get enter into a liquid state. It is nothing but called as liquefaction time. Okay, how much time it is required for the suppository to get converted to a liquid? That is liquefaction time. And what is the temperature? What is the temperature at which your suppository will get converted to a liquid? That is nothing but liquefaction time and temperature. We'll see with the procedure. For liquefaction time and temperature was done using fabricated instrument. A big pipette was taken having a narrow opening on one side and broad opening on another side. The pipette was dipped into hot water maintained at 37 degree centigrade. So what is the procedure involved for the determination of liquefaction time and temperature? You need to take a big pipette. I hope everyone know about the pipette. You need to take a big pipette, and pipette should be fabricated in such a way that at one end it should have narrow end and the other end it should have a broad opening. Okay. Now this particular pipette was dipped into hot water. That hot water temperature maintained at 37 degree centigrade. So how to dip into the hot water? So always you need to dip it into the hot water by narrow end facing towards your hot water. Your narrow end of your pipette should be facing towards your hot water. This is how you need to dip it into hot water. Now, the sample suppository was introduced from the top of the pipette through broad end. From the broad end, what you need to do? Some amount of the crust suppository, sample suppository, you just insert into the broad end of your pipette and just keep on inserting till it reaches to the narrow end, tip of your narrow end, and carefully push down its length until it reaches to your narrow end. After pushing towards the narrow end, now a glass rod was then inserted. So glass rod was then inserted through your broad end so that it rests over, just it rests over the suppository. After that, what will happen? The temperature at which glass rod just come down was noted, that represents the liquefaction temperature. So the time at which glass rod reaches to narrow end after complete melting of the suppository represents your liquefaction time. Okay, so let me explain you clearly. You need to take a very big pipette. Okay, that big pipette should be fabricated in such a way that at one side you will be having a narrow end, at the other side you will be having a broad end. Okay, so after that you need to take a vessel. That vessel will be containing water, and that particular water should be maintained at a temperature of 37 degrees. And this particular pipette having narrow end, it should be immersed into a water. It should be immersed into water in such a way that narrow end facing towards your hot water. After that, through the broad end, what you need to do, you just start inserting the suppositories through the broad end and start pushing the suppositories towards the narrow end, to the end of your narrow end. After that, after pushing 3 to 4 suppository, just you place one glass rod onto your suppository. On placing the glass rod, because already the suppositories are having some consistency, this glass rod cannot move here. Just place it on a rest position. Okay. And after that, what happens as the temperature gets increased, so your glass rod will start moving through your suppository. Okay, glass rod starts moving through your suppository. So when the glass rod starts moving through the suppository, that particular temperature is nothing but called as liquefaction temperature. And when the glass rod completely moves throughout your suppository mass, how it will move towards your suppository mass? When your entire suppository starts melting, your glass rod will be able to move towards your suppository mass and it will reach to the end of your tip, narrow end. End of your narrow end. That particular time is nothing but called as liquefaction time. Clear? I hope everyone are clear with the concept involved in the determination of liquefaction time and temperature. Next. Next, coming to the disintegration test, ma. Next test is disintegration test. Make a note, ma. Next test is disintegration test. All these tests, evolution parameters are something to understand and write on your own, ma. What is the concept involved? How the apparatus has been set up? Okay, just understand the points and start writing. Okay, so disintegration test, ma. The disintegration test was performed on 6 suppositories of each type using USB tablet disintegration apparatus. So here you are going to take an apparatus called as disintegration test apparatus. The type is USB type. Okay. And the model it has been given here as Electrolab ED2L. Okay. This is the model name. So 160 ml of distilled water was used as a medium. The medium used for carrying out this disintegration test is 160 ml. How much temperature you have to maintain? 36 to 37 degrees centigrade. How much temperature you have to maintain? 36 to 37 degrees centigrade. So suppositories or rectal capsules, examine the state of sample after 30 minutes for fat based suppositories. As I said, there are two types of suppositories can be prepared. One are water soluble suppositories, some are fat based suppositories. So why these two types? You know, it depends upon the type of base employed in the preparation of your suppositories. If you are using fat based suppositories, you need to examine the disintegration of the suppositories after 30 minutes. When you use water soluble suppositories, you need to examine after 60 minutes. Okay, this is everything about your disintegration test. So time taken for the suppository to disintegrate is called as disintegration test mark. Okay, that time has to be recorded by using an apparatus called as disintegration test apparatus. Okay, next test is your content uniformity. Next test is your content uniformity. So in order to ensure content uniformity, individual suppositories must be analyzed to provide uniform dose-to-dose uniformity. What is content uniformity? For example, yesterday, if you can remember the example, boric acid suppository, the Rx of the boric acid suppository is 120 mg per suppository. This is the dose given for each suppository. How do you know that every suppository will contain 120 mg? So that can be determined by a test called as content uniformity test. Okay. So this test is based on the assay of individual content of drug substance. How to do this content uniformity test? It will be based upon the assay. Okay. In number of individual dosage units to determine whether the individual content is within the limits or not. So it is not like one suppository should contain 120 mg means it will not be 120 mg. It will change its dose. So there are limits that are provided for each and every type of suppositories. So assay values always will be ranging. There will be no perfect assay limit will be there. So 85 to 90%, 85 to 110%, 85 to 120%. So your suppository should lie between the range of 85 to 115 means when you do the assay for that suppository should give a result 85 to 115%. In between 85 to 115%, then only it passes the test. So acceptance value, as I said, there are some limits, right? So here acceptance value calculations are not required for suppositories. Assay 10 units individually as directed in the assay in the individual monograph, unless otherwise specified in the procedure for content uniformity. So for every assay you carried out for individual drugs, assay procedure will be mentioned in the individual monograph. When you say individual monograph, that might be USP, that might be BP, that might be IP monograph. Clear? So if that particular procedure is not mentioned, what you have to do, just you need to take 10 units from the suppositories and you need to carry out assay. After carrying out an assay, you'll be getting some result, right? After getting the result, there are some limits given here. If one unit is outside the range of 85 to 115% of label claim and no unit is outside the range of 75 to 125% of label claim, so or if the relative standard deviation is greater than 6% or if both conditions prevail, test 20 additional unit. So when you check for the assay for each and every unit of the suppositories, here there is a limit given. Okay. If out of 10 units you have checked, if any one unit is outside the range of 85 to 115%, less than 85 or more than 115, or no unit is outside the range of 75 to 125, if these particular conditions are prevailed, then ultimately you need to go for testing for additional 20 suppositories. So that means that your suppository tested should be between 85 to 115 range mark. If it is less than or more than, okay, you will be given a second chance, that 75 to 125%. So if that's a particular second chance also, if you have missed, then you need to go for testing additional 20 units. Testing additional 20 units. So this is about content uniformity. Here limits are very important. Okay. Yeah, next. Coming to the dissolution test. What do you mean by dissolution test? Dissolution test always will give you for how much time, how much amount of the drug has been released into your rectum. Okay. So previously also I have been explained through your classes also. Dissolution is nothing but to test how much amount of the drug has been entered into your system in order to detect that dissolution studies will be carried out. So by using different types of apparatus such as wire mesh basket, the apparatus used as wire mesh basket or dialysis tubing is used to test for in vitro release from suppositories. In vitro release means outside the body, ma. In vivo release means inside the body. Keep this terminology, ma. In vitro, outside the body. Studies carried out outside the bodies. In vivo, studies carried out inside the bodies. So here we are going to do in vitro release studies for suppositories by using two apparatus. One is wire mesh basket. The other one is dialysis tubing. So two types of apparatus are available for testing the dissolution rate. There are first one suppository dialysis cell. Suppository dialysis cell. This is the first apparatus used for determining the dissolution rate. So lipophilic suppositories are tested using suppository dialysis cell and by wrapping them in foils. Okay, any suppositories that are lipophilic in nature, lipophilic means nothing but fat-based suppositories. You can go for applying a method called as suppository dialysis cell method in order to determine the dissolution rate. Okay, and next method is stationary basket method. Next method is stationary basket method. Here the apparatus used is dissolution test apparatus, that is nothing but USP dissolution test apparatus, and the apparatus type is rotating paddle apparatus. So here hydrophilic suppositories are tested using stationary basket. As I said, wire mesh baskets will be there, right? It is for hydrophilic suppositories. So as I said you before also, two types of suppositories, hydrophilic suppositories and lipophilic suppositories. The same thing we have come across with your disintegration. Do you remember? So fat-based suppositories should be checked after examining after 30 minutes, but hydrophilic suppositories should be checked after examining after 60 minutes. Okay. Next, stability testing. Stability testing. Last method is, last evolution parameter is stability testing. So why you need to check the stability? Because after preparation of the suppositories, you will be giving some shelf life to the product. So when you say 6 months or 1 year, so you need to ensure that till that 6 months of 1 year, this particular suppository product will maintain its integrity, like your weight variation, assay, dissolution, disintegration, all this particular, it has to maintain its limits. Then only you can say that that suppository has a good integrity. So main stability problem that has been noticed here is cocoa butter suppositories on storage. Any suppository that has been prepared from a base called as cocoa butter on storage, it will bloom. Blooming is nothing but they form a white powdery deposit on the surface. If you check the suppository surface at the bottom of your suppository, you can see some white powdery deposit. So this white powdery deposit is a sign of degradation. This can be avoided by storing the suppositories at uniform cool temperature. That white deposit can be avoided by storing the suppositories uniform cool temperature. So stability studies, short-term stability studies are carried out by subjecting the samples to different storage conditions. You need to keep on subjecting. So how do you know that that particular suppository should be stored in refrigerator? So on studying the stability studies only, people will come to know, or formulators or your pharmaceutical industry people will come to conclusion that, okay, this suppository is sensitive to this temperature. This suppository is having a very good shelf life during this temperature. So first they will subject the suppositories to high stress conditions, ma. When you say stress, it might be humid conditions, it might be high temperature conditions. When they subject to these particular conditions, they will come to a conclusion about what is the storage of that dosage form, where it has to be stored, how it has to be stored, what are the auxiliary labels that can be quoted onto the dosage form. Everything can be known based upon the stability studies. So what do you mean by shelf life? Time taken for the drug to degrade 90% of its initial concentration is called as shelf life. That particular shelf life can be fixed based upon the stability testing. That's all about the evolution parameters for suppositories. By this, we have completed 4 sessions of your suppositories and pessaries. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.